start our worship, and we're going to start it off with the Apostles' Creed. If you've already memorized it, you can close your eyes and try to recite it with us, but if you don't know, you can recite along with us and try to memorize. This is our confession of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hi guys, welcome to our Sunday worship service here at Bethel, and my name is Pastor Daniel, and I'm currently the junior high pastor here at our church. I hope that everyone is doing well for those of you who are watching this online, and some of you may actually recognize me from the Mystery Island videos as I was one of the pirates, and today, instead of being a pirate, I am going to be your pastor. So without further ado, let's dive right into what the Lord has to speak to us through His Word today. Let's pray. Father God, we ask and pray that you will touch our hearts for those who are listening to this sermon, God, that you will come in and make room within our hearts, and that you will speak to us individually and distinctively, Father, so that we may listen to you, we may hear the voice of God, and be strengthened to walk in this life and this journey of faith. Father God, we thank you that you love us so much through your Son, Christ Jesus, and all that he has done. We glorify you, we give you thanks, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Awesome. Now, we're going to continue on with the sermon series on power of words, and today we're going to specifically look at how Jesus' words have strong power and how his voice is dominant over the wind and the waves and the seas. So if you have your Bibles, please turn with me to the book of Luke chapter 8, and we're going to read from verses 22 to 25. And this passage is titled, Jesus Calming a Storm. One day, Jesus got into a boat with his disciples. He said to them, "Let us go across to the other side of the lake." They set out. On the way, Jesus fell asleep. A fierce storm came onto the lake. A lot of water went into the boat. They were in danger because it might sink. Okay, let's stop right there. So, in today's story, Jesus along with his disciples are traveling across the lake with a boat, and Jesus fell asleep along the way because he was tired. And while he fell asleep, a fierce storm, not a regular storm, but a fierce storm came onto the lake. And just imagine a hurricane on the lake where the disciples were, wind blowing back and forth violently and tremendous waves forming left and right. And the boat that the disciples were on wasn't even designed to battle storms. It was just a simple, plain boat made for traveling, and the boat could literally be flipped upside down at any moment now, and all the people are in the boat are just panicking because they're in danger of death. Let's go on to verse 24. They woke Jesus and shouted, "Master, Master, we're going to drown." Jesus woke up. He ordered the wind and the stormy waves to stop. The wind and the waves obeyed him. All became calm. Amen. Man, today's story, it's that short and that anticlimactic. The disciples are in danger of dying, and Jesus completely shuts out and silences the wind and the stormy waves that are threatening the lives of his disciples by simply commanding it to stop. And when he did, all became calm immediately. And Jesus, who is our Lord and Savior, the Son of God, the one we believe in, has the power over all the storms and all the hurricanes in life. Amen? He has the power over nature, sin, and death. And he also has power over all the forces that's trying to kill us and drown us. And I'm talking about Satan, the murderer. And God's words, Jesus' words, are so mighty and so powerful that even the winds and the waves obey him. And there is absolutely nothing that can compare to the power and the glory of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And Psalm 29 says, "The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic." Amen. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning, and because Jesus has that much power in his words, in his voice, he did not have to worry like the disciples who were panicking in the boat. And my brothers and sisters in Christ, our Bethel Elementary students, the question I want to ask you today is, do you believe in the power of God's voice? Do you believe in the power of God's words? Because scripture says that when God speaks, nothing becomes something. Just like the creation story in Genesis 1, how he spoke the whole world into being, and impossibility becomes possibility. If God speaks, it will be so, period. End of story. And this story ends in this way, verse 25. Jesus said to them, "Where is your faith?" They were afraid and astonished. They asked one another, "Who is this man who gives orders to wind and water, and they obey him?" Amen. And the disciples, they were asking, who is Jesus? Who is Jesus Christ? Even though he was right next to him. Who is this man who silences the wind and the water and gives orders to the sea and the storm? Who is this man who heals every incurable diseases in the town of Israel? Who is this man who speaks with so much authority and power about the kingdom of heaven? Who is this man, Jesus Christ? And the disciples are asking each other, and they were legit confused because his power of words had no limit. Whatever he said, no matter how hard the task was, it got done immediately. And Jesus, through today's story, proves that he was not a regular human being like the rest of us. Amen? He was God in flesh, which means he was fully God and fully man. And the scripture says that he came down from heaven to earth for one very specific reason, which is to save you and I from our sins. And how did he do that? The Bible says that by dying on the cross for you. He took upon your sins at the cross and crucified him along with his flesh. And this man, Jesus, that you heard about today, he had a great power in his words. And the scripture says that on the day of his death, funny thing is, he did not speak against his enemies and remain silent. Isaiah 53, verses 6 to 7 says, we all like sheep have gone astray. Each one has turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. And though Jesus could have called upon his Father, who would have sent 12 legions of angels immediately to eliminate all those who are mocking him, the scripture says that Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, did not open his mouth on the day of judgment for you and I to take our judgment on our behalf, receiving God's wrath in full for us. And at this time, I want to lead you guys into a quick time of prayer. And I want us to pray for thanksgiving for what Jesus has done for you and me. He is great in power, mighty in his words, and instead of showing off his powers to the rest of the world as a dominant, bossy king, instead he decided to serve us by dying at an early age of 33 to give us hope and to give us eternal life. And very few people will die to save the life of someone else, even if it is good, even if that person is a good person. And yet, Christ died for us while we were sinners and made a way for us to the Father in heaven. So at this time, I'm going to end this in prayer, and let's pray to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, giving thanks to him. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you, O Lord, the very God that we believe and worship, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. O Lord, at this time, we confess that you're powerful, you're majestic, and your voice covers over the waters, and it has the power to silence and shut off anything, including hurricanes, tsunamis, waves, and the storms. And Father, we also thank you that you did not abuse that power to really show off as a prideful king, but rather, even though you had that power, you decided to die a humble death for us on the cross. So Father, at this time, we praise your humility, we praise the sacrifice that you have given us, and we praise, Father God, the death that you have given us as well. Father God, we thank you that we could worship a humble king like you are, and we thank you that you have died and resurrected for us so that we can experience the same death and victory that you have experienced on the cross. We thank you, Jesus, for your death, for atoning for our sins, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi there, I'm Pastor Kevin. It's time for questions from kids. Cole from Upper Marlboro, Maryland asks,
is it okay to hit my brother if he hit me first?
Oh man, listen, I grew up in a home with a younger brother and an older brother and even an older sister. And they hit me a time or two and I hit them a time or two, probably more like hundreds of times. And I was wrong for hitting them. And my big brother and younger brother and older sister, they were wrong for hitting me too. Because the Bible tells us that we shouldn't hit one another. Now the question we have to ask ourselves is, hey, what caused me to want to hit them back, or what caused them to want to hit me in the first place? Well, frankly, sometimes it's just pride. I was hurt when my older brother would punch me, and I wanted to respond in a way that would help my pride. Sometimes he even hurt me physically, and I wanted to, you know what? I wanted to cause him physical pain too. But both of those responses are unbiblical and wrong, Cole. And so what we want to do as believers is we want to live a life that is pleasing to Christ Jesus, because Christ wouldn't hit somebody back if they hit him. And we want to be different. We want to be like him. As a matter of fact, scripture tells us that if someone hits you, we should just turn the other cheek. And that's what the Bible tells us to do. Now, as we think about Jacob and Esau and his brothers, this story could have gone one or two ways. A brother returns and instead of hitting or hurting a brother that it hurt him, that's not what he did. He loved his brother, and he cared for his brother, and he showed compassion for his brother. So even when people hit you, we're called to love them, and we're called to show compassion to them, whether they're older than us or even if they're younger than us. We should love them. Now, we also have to ask ourselves the question, how can we be different? You see, the world is going to tell you that if somebody hits you, that you should hit them back. And that's wrong. And the world will tell us many things that are different to what the Holy Scripture, different than what the Bible tells us to do. So oftentimes when we find ourselves in tough situations, we have to ask ourselves the question, what does the Bible tell me to do? And oftentimes it's going to be different than what the world tells us to do, because the world has its own ways and the Scripture and the Bible has a way in which we ought to live. The Bible calls us to be different. Now, I don't want you to think you're the first person that has to live different, because any Christian, any believer who wants to walk with Christ and who wants to love the Lord and love the world, we're called to be different. And so, Cole, there are a bunch of little kids trying to live different. There are a bunch of adults that are living different. And so I want you to be different. Can you think of other ways God calls believers to live differently than the world?
Now it is time for offering. Second service starts at 9 a.m. and third service starts at 11 a.m. Make sure to memorize the Bible memory verse in order to play some fun memory verse games. We will be decorating a Christmas tree until next week, so make sure to bring one ornament to decorate the tree and celebrate Jesus' birthday together. The Bible memory verse contest is today. For those of you who memorized Matthew chapter 6, verse 19 to 34, you guys would have all earned 300 points and a huge trophy. The Golden Bell quiz is also today. For those of you who get first place in this quiz, you will get this prize. Woo! For those of you who get second place, you'll get this prize. Woo! And for those of you who get third place, you'll get this prize. Yay! Don't these prizes look amazing? All of you guys did such a great job. Teacher Chunhee and Teacher Haewon are getting married on December 15th on Thursday. Teacher Chunhee and Teacher Haewon, you are in our thoughts and prayers on this special day. Lastly, we are still waiting for the Count Your Blessings prize. We apologize for the delay and thank you for your patience. It's already December. Remember, Jesus Christ came down to earth for you and me because he loves all of us. I hope all of you guys have a great week. Bye!
Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.